Hello, I'm Dr. Cynthia First from the University of Utah, and I'd like to present our paper on miniaturization of implantable antennas and a discussion of the concentration of the fields. The students who have been involved in this project are Tara Spafford, Caitlin Hall, Carter Christensen, myself, of course, Joseph Kiflom, Christopher Trampel, Kelsey Tyler, Valeria Corona, Sean McKellar. We're from the Electrical and Computer Engineering Department at the University of Utah. Implantable medical devices have created a demand for implantable antennas. Pacemakers and defibrillators are the first and most commonly identified implantable devices, but also the artificial pancreas, cochlear implant, retinal implant, and deep brain stimulation devices. All of these devices need both telemetry for data and also wireless power transfer, and that's what these antennas are used for. The telemetry challenges are that the larger the frequency, the higher the frequency, the smaller the antenna. That's great. But the higher the frequency, the less penetration we have, and that's a challenge. So the frequencies that are feasible for this application are either the industrial, scientific, medical bands, 433, 915, or 2450 megahertz, or the dedicated MIX, medical implant communication services band, from 402 to 405 megahertz. This was established in 1999 and expanded to the med radio band in 2009, so 401 to 406 megahertz. So you're going to hear me talking about these two bands and the 433 megahertz that's close by. So the challenge of next generation implantable stimulation devices are today's devices, the battery pack, and the communication systems are generally 2 to 4 centimeters on a side. But in the next generation, we'd like to be able to use very small devices, such as the Utah electrode array, and package a battery and electronics on top of that. And that device is only 4 millimeter on a side. So being able to shrink from a device that's 2 to 4 centimeters to 4 millimeters is a big challenge for antennas. Let's consider how antennas get shrunk. So planar inverted F antennas, or PIFA antennas, could commonly be used on these devices. A PIFA is an antenna radiator connected by a feed and ground pin to the ground plane. The ground pin actually effectively doubles the size of the radiator by making it act like it has a virtual antenna nearby. The substrate and superstrate materials that hold the antenna and also insulate it from short circuiting in the body help to reduce the size of the antenna too. As you increase the dielectric properties of these substrate and superstrate materials, you can shrink your antenna substantially. The body also helps to shrink the antenna because it has a relatively high dielectric constant as well, and that produces a smaller antenna. Now that's how we've been able to produce antennas that are 2 to 4 centimeters on a side that are working in either 433 megahertz or the 401 to 405 megahertz regions. So typically the antenna radiator would be spiraled up or maybe serpentined and connected onto the battery pack as shown. So that's how antennas are shrunk today. But it remains a challenge when you want to stay in the same frequency so that you can have good penetration in the body, but yet you want to drop to a 4 millimeter size package. In free space, the half wavelength at 433 megahertz is about 36 centimeters. In the body, it's about 5 to 6 centimeters, but how can we shrink to get to 4 millimeters? So this actually requires thinking outside the box. In fact, thinking outside of the battery pack box. One example of this is something that we have proposed where you can do a tattoo antenna in the fat layer of the body. You could tattoo conductive nanoparticles near the surface in the low loss fat layer, and the tattoo can be quite large. The feed system on the implanted device could be very small, perhaps even 4 millimeters, and you could couple through a few centimeters of tissue to connect the implanted feed to the surface tattoo. Another possibility is to use concentrating rods or loops to be able to use either a plane wave or this subdermal antenna and be able to collect the fields from a large region and concentrate them down on the very small device that could be implanted in the body. So here's an example of concentrating rods, and you know that fields concentrate at tips and gaps of metallic objects. Now, it'd be great to just implant some wires in the body, but that's not a very good thing for medically. So we came up with a possibility of using conductive polymers that can be quite soft, that could be implanted in the body, kind of like 3D printing in the body. So you could use a cardiac ablation probe or some other open-ended coaxial probe, inject the polymer, as shown here on the right, inject the polymer heat it back out and basically extrude a wire of this type. So the possibility of producing concentrating rods using heat-activated polymers is very realistic, actually, and that is able to concentrate the power at the very small implant to the tune of about 16 times as much power as you could have without the rods. Now, the designs that we have done in the past, we've assumed that either we've evaluated what would happen if you had a plane wave outside the body. In this particular presentation, I'm going to talk about two different types of realistic antennas that would be used in the body. So one is a loop antenna, shown here, the other is a dipole. So instead of just considering how these focusing rods might work if we had a plane wave, let's see what would happen if we had a loop antenna outside the body and a very tiny loop on the implant, or a dipole outside the body and a very tiny dipole on the implant. And we're going to look at 433 megahertz because that's a frequency that we could test in our labs that is very close to the 402 to 405 megahertz mixed band. The goal is to increase the power, or the SAR, at the implant location. And we have to also remember that the SAR limit of 1.6 watts per kilogram over 1 gram of tissue also applies. The SAR limit is going to be difficult to maintain on the fields that are outside the body, that are getting very close to the body. But we want to be sure that we get the power stronger where the implant is. So here's an example of a model for the coils. We could use a polyimide casing for the coil to keep it from short-circuiting against the body. And we could have skin, fat, and muscle. And here are the properties shown here. In this case, we're going to model the polymer wires having the same conductivity as copper, although we have found that any conductivity of 10 to the fifth and up is going to act very similar. So let's first look at the transmit and receiver coils. The transmit coil is a relatively large coil outside the body. It's produced on FR4, and it has a polyimide casing. All of this is simulated at this point. And then we have a receiver coil that's much smaller that could be on the 4 millimeter implant. And then if we are considering focusing rods, as we will in some of our cases, the focusing rods are not actually touching the internal antenna. They are just getting close to it. So there's passive coupling between the rods and the internal antenna, the receiver coil. So we're going to look at four cases. We're going to look at the transmit and receive coil with no focusing rods. We're going to look at the transmit and receive coil with three focusing coils, shown here, and then with two focusing rods, and then with three focusing rods. So let's see how these different systems work. So let's first look at the case where we have a coil in the polyimide. It's actually above the skin in this case, so it's an external transmitting coil, and it's trying to transmit to the very small implantable medical device, which is buried 60 millimeters below the body. So here's the specific absorption rate. You can see that the external coil creates a substantial SAR on the very near surface of the body. That's where the limit of 1.6 watts per kilogram is going to come in. And in the picture that I'm showing here, the maximum SAR that's shown is actually 1.68, just a tiny bit above that allowable SAR. Now, in the case where we have no focusing, the S21, the transmission between the external coil, which is port one, and the internal implant, which is port two, at 433 megahertz is minus 74 dB. Not very high, but considering that we have a large amount of lossy body, understandable. Here are the electric fields. Now, particularly notice the polarizations as they pass from the coil into the body. And it's a little loop coil that we're trying to pick these up with inside. So here are the electric fields. Now let's consider the case where we have three focusing coils. Now in our previous simulations, we showed that the coils were able to increase the amount of power by a factor of about 2 to 4, depending on the coils. So let's see how this actually, and that's with the plane wave. Let's see how this actually works if we have a polyimide coil being the transmitter coil and a small coil at the IMD as well. Well, in this case, it really didn't give us the kind of pickup that we would have liked. So although the SAR is larger, when we add the rings, enough of it wasn't picked up by the internal coil to make very much difference. In fact, it was a little bit worse. The S21 with these rings is minus 80 dB. And here are the electric fields. So nice and strong there. Now let's see what happens if we use the two rod focusing system. So now we have an external coil, an internal IMD coil, and we're going to see about using the rods as a focusing system. In this case, we could get an increase of about 16 times the amount of power if we had a plane wave, and let's see how that's going to work for our coils. Well, our SAR is definitely larger. We can clearly see that the rods are doing a good job increasing the amount of power that's down at the second coil. However, it's not really being picked up. In fact, it's also a little bit worse than just when we had just the two coils. And so the amount of power, the S21, is minus 76 decibels. Again, not really a great improvement there. Now the power is there. What's happening is it's not being picked up by the coils. So we need to reevaluate the internal antenna and see if we can pick up more of the energy that is being concentrated at that location. Here are the electric fields. Now, it's no wonder that this coil is not picking them up, because you can see that the polarization of the coils is not really matching the polarization of the coil well. So this is one of the things that we're going to be working on in future work. Now let's evaluate what would happen if we had a four-rod focusing system. That's where we've got two rods in one direction and then two rods perpendicular to them as well. We should see additional pickups. So the rods again are laid out in this crossed V dipole state. Well, again, we can see substantial increase in the SAR. In fact, we've increased the SAR almost double at this point. But again, not a lot of it is being picked up by the internal IMD antennas. So we do need to do a better job with the IMD antenna design if we want to be able to use a coil system. And again, here are the electric fields, and we can see why they are certainly stronger. They are being concentrated by the rods, but they are not being picked up well by the coil. So in conclusion, when we have no focusing, and even if we use three rings, two rods, four rods, we get more power into the location that we want, but we don't do a great job picking it up. So future improvements are improving the matching. The S11 for all of these internal coils is on the order of 10 decibels. So we can probably do a better job with the matching, and also changing the antenna so that we do a better job picking up the polarization that's actually concentrated at that location. Now let's evaluate what would happen if instead of using an external coil, we used an external dipole, and instead of using an internal coil, we used an internal dipole. So the dipole outside the body is roughly 9 centimeters long, so it's a big antenna outside the body. And I might mention that the subdermal dipole and the dipole that's right on the surface of the body act very, very similar. The skin doesn't do very much to change the performance of these antennas. The implanted dipole would fit on a 4 millimeter, would just about fit on a 4 millimeter implantable medical device. So this is what happens with the SAR in this case. Notice that we've got a dipole antenna above and a dipole antenna below, and we end up with a very uniform SAR pattern actually here. So when we considered loops with no focusing, the S21 was minus 74 dB. The dipoles, on the other hand, with no focusing are better at minus 44 decibels. So already we're seeing a better transfer of power from a dipole on the outside to a dipole on the inside. Now, if we need to limit the SAR to 1.6 watts per kilogram, which we do, the maximum SAR shown in the previous picture was 81.6 watts. So, and that's stimulated with 9 milliwatts of power. So to get the SAR down to within limits of 1.6, we'd need to decrease this by a factor of 51, which would give a maximum allowed radiated power of 0.1 milliwatts. Now, here are the fields that we are seeing on the implant, on the internal dipole. And we can see why these are being picked up better, because we are at matching the polarization better than we did in the case of the loops. Here are the Smith charts that are representing the outer dipole and the inner dipole. And you can see the outer dipole is actually quite well matched, and the inner dipole probably would be better matchable. So if we added a matching network for this dipole, it's a very small dipole. Now let's see what would happen if we use the internal and external dipole and we add focusing rods, like the polymer rods that we've mentioned before. So in this case, we can see that there is some concentration of power at the location of the implant. And in fact, we see a substantial improvement. So we went from dipoles with no focusing having an S21 of minus 44 decibels to dipoles with two rods of having a S21 of minus 19.2 decibels. This is a substantial improvement, and both of these are better than our loop case. So again, we have a maximum SAR in this case of 81.5, and we need to divide that down. So we have end up with a total maximum allowed radiated power in this case of about 0.2 milliwatts. And this is what the implanted fields look like. You can actually see how the rods are concentrating the energy. They actually are kind of picking it up and guiding it down the rod towards the implantable medical device. Now remember, they are not touching directly. There is capacitive coupling or inductive, there's passive coupling to the medical implant, and the rods are helping substantially. Here are the matching networks for the system with and without the rods, and the rods actually also help to match the antenna, and that's part of what's giving us the substantial improvement in the S21. So the first antenna, the outer dipole, is reasonably well matched. Probably we wouldn't do much there. And in this case, the inner dipole is as well. So let's take a kind of a summary comparison of our dipole case with and without the field focusing. So you can see that the S11 is very similar in for the outer dipole, makes very little difference, but it substantially helps to match the inner dipole. As a result, the S21 and the S12 are much better for the dipole that has the field focusing rods. And then here are the patterns of energy. So here are the SAR patterns, and you can see with no rods, the energy is concentrated under the dipole, but with rods, we're able to get much more power down to the dipole, to the implantable medical device. So in future work, we expect to fabricate and test this device, increase the number of turns in the coils, and also try a cross-dipole design for our receive system. In addition, we will be better matching the antennas. And in the case of the loops, we will have to probably do a different type of antenna to improve the polarization match. Now, I'll be glad to address any questions. My contact information is here, and you can find several of our publications on the website emlab.eng.utah.edu. Thank you very much.